there, because I've got another question here that's for you. But before I ask you that, let me just go to Ade. Ade, given what Miss Ara has kind of, with the lack of better word, schooled us on, do you understand the process of when people transition? Am I using the right terminology?
You can use the word transition. Sometimes I don't use it, but other trans people use it.
Okay. That it can be very stressful, painful, costly. And for it's not just something that you would wake up and just decide this is what I want to do today. So do you understand that as how they would feel and how, with a lack of better word, unaccepted people will feel if not putting you on the spot when people or men or even women feel the way that you feel?
Well, you know what? It's not about her being transgender or whatever it is. I've actually done voluntary work with the healing LGBT groups in the past, and there's a lot of Muslim guys who are actually gay. And when they tell you their story, what they go through, they couldn't come out because of the fear of persecution and hatred from their family and stuff. So I understand where she's coming from. She understands, and I feel their pain. But what I'm saying is, me as a man, as a person, do you know what I mean? If I don't know, say you understand, I don't want to know, right? Then I wouldn't have any thought of, oh yeah, you understand? So, and if she tells me she is, I don't hate the person, but I will struggle to form a sexual relationship with that person. Do you understand what I'm saying? I might find the person attractive, but I will struggle. And it's not, I'm not religious because I don't follow any religion. I just tell people I'm Muslim. It's not about whether you go to church or mosque. They're just selling the market. As far as
I'm concerned. Why would you struggle?
No, because of knowing that person, you know, in my head was giving birth to as a male or as a female turned to man, whatever. That's where I'll struggle to bypass and ignore that fact. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because I see that as a fact about that person. You know, it's not a fiction. It's a fact. You know, and that's where I struggle. You know, I don't have a problem with them. My son can get up tomorrow and become a trans. I wouldn't hate my son. I've always said my son grew up and be gay. Mm-hmm. He's my son. Do you understand? I don't have any hatred towards them. But it's just for me to now see me say, maybe if I'm drunk, you and I didn't know. You understand? But if I'm really sane and I'm fully aware, I won't go there. Because in my mind, that dick will not get hurt because I'm thinking,
I think in a way I understand what Ade is trying to say. As boys growing up, the society programmed us to appreciate the girls as the opposite sex. To be frank, I see a fellow man come, I will blow the person. Are you mad? Shake it. But I think where the whole thing changes is when you now grow up and you know the combination and composition of the world, that there are different people, different individuals, different way people think, which might actually not go in the same line with the society or the norms we grew up with. So opening your mind, like I said in the last show, opening your mind to this, just like you leave Nigeria for different opportunities abroad. You could have stayed in Nigeria, but you decided to leave to explore what is there for you. You found the place that is comfortable and you stayed. You could have gone back home, but you didn't. So that's the way I look at it, in the sense that, yeah, there are a lot of different people out there. And I really, really thank Miss Sarah. I thought I knew a lot. Of course, I'm open-minded. But with the things I've heard tonight, I've even learned more from her. So it has to do with you opening up your mind, and I'm open to I don't want to say experiment or whatever. I'm open to new things. You get?
Yeah, but that is you. You know, not everybody are like that. Not everybody are that flexible, and that is the point I was trying to make. I totally agree where Ade is coming from. And that is why I'm saying to Ade that not everybody will be willing to open their mind like you have. And not everybody will be willing to, like, some we human beings can be very stubborn. And we know one thing and say, that's it, I'm not changing my views, which is totally understandable. The only way you change your views and learn things is when you open your mind, because the world is bigger than us. Mm. We are not the only one. When we look at our planet, we look at Earth, thinking that Earth is very big. Meanwhile, we're just a tiny, 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 minuscule speck in the universe. When you look at our Milky Way, when I love my astronomy and I like to watch TV shows like The Universe on BBC. You know, you go and watch things like that and see that there are so many things that are bigger than us. We have to also remember, because when we, as human beings, we always believe of our own self-importance and believe that what we know is universal, but there is things that are beyond that. Having an open mind and understanding biology, number one, especially when it comes to LGBT people, you need to think about biology. It's not so straightforward. Just because you're used to seeing only straight people around you doesn't mean that everyone is straight. Mm-hmm. Just because you only see cisgender people, cisgender meaning you guys, people who are born who don't have any issues with the gender they were assigned at birth, because gender is assigned. It is a social construct. But then again, who I am as a person, for me, is very biological. How I feel and who I am and I identify and present, that comes from my brain. If my brain tells me today, Sahara, dress up as a man, grow beard, okay, maybe I'll go and start taking testosterone or something and start doing that. But my brain will not tell me that, because my brain is so well cooked and so well, it's developed as a woman, and it's always felt like any other woman. And that's why I used to question people when I was growing up as a child. When people go like, oh, go and play football with the boys, stop sitting in the kitchen with your grandmama constantly. I'm like, why would they be saying that to me? And my grandma would tell them to leave me alone. That is the way I am. You know, that is because that is who I am. I want to play with the girls, dance with the girls, and do my own thing. I don't want to be with the boys because I don't feel comfortable with the boys, because they're the opposite sex. Why do I want to go and be with them? And then they say, oh, you're a boy. This, and I see that thing hanging. I'm like, what the fuck is that? I'm not having that. I don't want it, you know? Mm-hmm. And I was so confused growing up in Nigeria with lack of education and lack, because what I'm saying right now could save a lot of lives, especially when it comes to trans lives in Nigeria. People who go through the same, who are going through what I'm going through right now. Do you know how many trans people that have murdered themselves and rather not murdered, but like committed suicide in Nigeria? Because they don't feel comfortable with who they are, and the society is vehemently telling them that they're not valid and they can never be a woman. So what I'm trying to say to Ade is that you need to educate yourself on that subject, because right now Google is your friend, and you live in the Western world where you have so much wealth of information. There is no reason for you to have that mindset to say that, oh, you're a man and you always be a man, or you're born male, you always be a male. When, if I sit with your wife today, she will have more testosterone in her body than I do, because she produces testosterone and I don't. I have more estrogen in my system.
Well, hold on, I don't know when, what age, wherever you change completely. Have you ever been with a woman where you was a...
Why would I be a woman? I'm not a lesbian.
No, you've never been.
Why would I be with a woman?
I think, Miss Sarah, I think what Ade wants to know is, before you started your journey...
Why would I be with a woman? Okay. I'm not a lesbian, don't you get it? You're not
because you had it, because in your mind you were a woman, so you couldn't be with a woman.
Woman, so nothing has changed. Taking hormones doesn't change any, it doesn't change your sexuality. This is a misconception too. People often assume that when you start taking hormones or having surgery, it's going to change your sexuality. No, Caitlyn Jenner, who is one of the Jenner clan, the Kardashian clan, Caitlyn Jenner still fancies women. She's still sleeping with women, even despite the fact she's had surgery, she's done everything. She's still sleeping with women. That's because she's a lesbian. Okay. It doesn't change who you are. It doesn't change your innate sense of self per se. The exterior could change, but who you are as a person is who you are. How can I sleep with a woman? I think
that was the other question I had, because someone sent in a question and wanted to know if you have ever been attracted to a woman.
Hell to the no.
Does you qualify?
I don't find you don't see it. I like.
See, I know you're trying to close up.
I find men attractive. I like a rough man, because I'm so feminine and so girly. Mm-hmm. I need a man to qualify me, like a really man.
You're out of the league.
Tall guys with big muscles or something.
Yeah.
Ade,
Ade, you don't qualify. Sorry.
I have some that I send away.
Sarah, I have one final question for you because I know Celia is about to wrap up.
Now, I also have one question, please, if you don't mind. Well, just last question.
Sarah, as a trans woman, and I know that you advocate for women a lot. Now, given the news that the Brits, there's not going to be a gender assigned category.
Yeah.
And you can see women are already marginalized. Don't you think that that decision, in as much as we're talking about equality, does that not segregate women even more?
You know, people have another misconception. Grammys don't have gendered category. Did you know that?
Yeah, Grammy, I'm aware of that.
Grammy does not have gender. So what are they losing? Nothing. So it's still similar to Grammys. So Grammys don't have best male, best female. It doesn't have that. It's neutral. It's been gender neutral since 2012. So I'm sorry, it doesn't lose anything. It's all about who you are being celebrated for, the work that you do. Most women will want that. Most women don't want something based on just you because you're a woman. You should get it because of your merit, because you're good at what you're doing. So when people are complaining about it, it's just because they're looking for any issue, any reasons to attack, you know, Daily Mail and the rest of British media, right-wing media, they hate trans people. So they will say anything to attack trans people. Have you noticed that on Daily Mail, they don't platform a woman like me? They won't platform someone like me because I don't fit the narrative. They like to take a mickey out of trans women who don't look the part and trans women who are gender non-binary because they know that they are the new boogie people. So they attack them and harass them because they feel that, oh, they fit that narrative more. Those are the kind of people that they go to because someone like me, just me being me alone, would debunk what they're saying. Because I am the type of trans woman that makes them feel comfortable.
Yes.
I'm the type of trans woman that they won't question, they won't go like, oh, you know, they won't have issues with because I blend in so well into society. But that is the problem. This is where this same thing that is going on in the world right now, this same discrimination also discriminates 6 women. Do you remember the last Olympic that happened? Remember the law that they passed in the Olympics, depriving trans women from joining Olympics? He also deprived cisgender women. Not just intersex, cisgender women. Cisgender women who are not intersex, cisgender women, black cisgender women from Kenya and is it Ethiopia? Namibia, I think. I can't remember the country. It deprived them from joining the Olympics as well because they were trying to attack trans people. So when they make these laws that trying to attack trans people, that trans women are men in dresses, it also goes back and attacks cisgender women, inadvertently attacks cisgender women as well. So they have to, black women in particular, just like those feminists who always claim that they're so-called, I call them so-called feminists, they call themselves radical feminists, who say that trans women are not women, like the type of feminism of J.K. Rowling, also rejects cis women who can carry children, cis women who can have babies. You also reject black cis women who don't look that bad, black cis women who don't look like the patriarchal definition of beauty, me. I'm the patriarchal definition of beauty. They don't want, there are so many cisgender women who don't look like me. Does that mean they're not valid? There are so many cisgender women who can carry babies. Does that mean they're not women? That is the thing. So when people start using that language and using the reason for, well, I don't want to date a trans woman because she can't have a baby. Well, I don't want a trans woman. You know, what they're saying is, I'm transphobic, own it, take the badge and be proud of it. And don't even go and get offended because someone called you transphobic. No, you are transphobic.
Okay.
So that's the concept.
All right. Kiom, did you have a question?
Yeah, I wanted to stress on the point that she was talking about, and then I reflected on what she spoke about before now concerning Africa, and especially let me speak for Nigeria, knowing the fact that this is where I came from and I understand the system and how it works a little bit. If transgender women in a developed society, let's say like America, let's just say the West entirely, are facing the same kind of a problem that maybe developing countries like Nigeria, you know, that don't have enough enlightenment and we're dealing with cultural stuff that has been inculcated in us for quite a long time. And we're growing up with that, and the society is not really sensitized to understand those things. Don't you think this is like a global issue, not only focus on maybe like Africa not being educated or Nigeria not giving the trans platform, can't we look at it on this side? Like if you you are facing the same thing in the UK, and then you have people in the US, you have people in Canada also facing the same thing. Don't you think this is a global issue, not actually being looking at it in one side?
Let me answer that. It's very simple. The privileges that I have in the UK here, my trans sisters don't have it in Nigeria because the law does not recognize trans people. There is a 14 years imprisonment for LGBT people in Nigeria. You can't even associate with the trans LGBT person. If you associate or hang out with them, you get a 9 years imprisonment. In Northern Nigeria, they are advocating for death sentence by stoning through Sharia law in Northern Nigeria. I'm a Nigerian, so I know the law very well. And I know my rights if I go to Nigeria. For example, I don't have a Nigerian passport because I'm worried that if I come back to Nigeria, I stand the chance of being put under the law based on Nigerian law because the law says someone like me should not exist. Yes, you have people like Risky are flaunting the laws and people like that in Nigeria. And many gay people are married to cisgender women, by the way. This is another very important issue that most Nigerians don't look at. There are lots of gay men and women married to the opposite sex in Nigeria, and their opposite sex partners do not know that they are gay. They go underground to play this away game and do chuki chuki with people on the underground. And I'm like, this is not the way to live your life just because the law, this is because the law and the society criminalizes it. The UK, as bad as it may be, in my opinion, it's still heaven compared to Nigeria. UK, Canada, US, New Zealand, any part of the world, Western world, is still far much better. We have a thing called the SOGI bill, which is anti-discrimination laws, where you cannot discriminate against anyone based on gender, sexuality, race. There are lots of laws protecting you by the government. Police protect you. Do you think the police will protect me in Nigeria? I was brutalized by the police by being locked up in prison when I was in Nigeria. When they found me wearing hip padding and looking very, what did they call me? Those woman rapper and all those dandao that they used to call me in those days when I was in Nigeria. They locked me up just because of nothing that has nothing to do with what I was looking like. Just because I look the way I look, they locked me up in the hottest parts in prison in Benue. And I will never forget that because that was my turning point. I was like, that's it. I'm leaving this country. So there are things that many of my trans sisters do not. One, medical, because being trans is medical. Being gay is not, is sexuality. So you can actually keep it on the down low and pretend, marry a cis woman and pretend to be married to her. Once in a while you have sex, you have to get her pregnant and still go about sleeping with your boyfriends in the back on the underground, which result in these women catching sexual transmitted diseases, by the way, because of their the promiscuity of their husbands. So someone like me would not be given that much privileges in the sense that medical, being a trans person, I need the medicine for me to survive. I need healthcare, I need protection. We don't have that in Nigeria. That is the reason why I focus on Nigeria. And this is the reason why I call out Nigeria, is because we don't have that protection. The church is against us, society is against us, the law is against us. We are not allowed to exist. The only way you can exist in Nigeria is to fake it until you make it, like we were saying earlier. Now, Risky has made it. Risky can go about and say, I'm rich. No one will touch her because if you have money in Nigeria, you can survive. If you have money in Nigeria, you can bribe your way through life. But how about those trans people who don't have nothing and trans people who are just poor, but they just want to be themselves and live their life freely and openly? There is no law to protect them. And this is why it's very important that we correct that. In the UK here, I have protection. If I don't have money and I'm very poor, I can lean on my government to help me. I don't have to end up doing sex work. In Nigeria, all the trans girls that I know that look good, including Risky, they're all doing sex work. In Nigeria, that is their only source of income. They can't even get a normal job to go to work. When they get a job, their bosses are telling them to stop dressing up to come to work. They have no protection unless it's an NGO that comes from the part of the world that allows them to be themselves. For example, let's say a charity organization that comes from the UK or America that is LGBT friendly will let them be themselves and use the right pronoun and the right name. When you use the right pronoun for a trans person, it's a feeling of euphoria. It makes you feel good about who you are because they are validating who you are. But in a situation where you're going to work every day and they're telling you, dress up like this, don't dress up like that, do this, do that, it dehumanizes you. It makes you feel like who you are is not real. And it's just the exterior. They're telling you to be something that you're not.
Mr. Hara, you said something earlier. You say you have a lot of friends that are trans women that are married to cis men.
Yeah.
And their husbands don't know. How is that possible?
Because legally, you are supposed to disclose it. But morally, you don't have to. But I choose morally to discuss it. Even my mom, when my mom came, when she finally accepted me, she said to me, you know, please don't out yourself. Just stay in the closet, be yourself, go back in the closet. I said, Mom, there's no such thing as coming out of the closet and then going back in. It's not possible because it's all over the place. She's like, well, you can actually just blend into society and just live your life peacefully and quietly, which is true. My life would be so much richer and better if I had gone quietly. But these women have seen what trans people go through and they all feel very uncomfortable. They feel like they are cis women. They look at themselves as cis women, which I feel like I'm like any other cis woman. Just because my life history is trans doesn't define me. It's just a reference for my future. Doesn't make my future. And that is another misconception people have, because people say, oh, you're trans. Oh, they'll always label you as trans. They see what trans people go through and they don't want to go into that territory. So they just live their life quietly. They call it stealth, living in stealth. Yeah. They live in stealth and just go quietly, living their life peacefully, doing things. Especially there's one that her husband doesn't even want children. So she's just perfect for him. So there is no need for thinking, oh, you need to have babies. There are lots of ways to make babies these days, by the way. But
so can I ask, so what of those that didn't disclose to their partners and their partners want babies? How do they then navigate that?
They will have to go and start using surrogacy and trying to navigate through going to a fertility clinic and doing things to try to make a baby. They always try to get a surrogate. Majority of them that I know always try to get a surrogate.
So are you saying at that point, they still wouldn't tell their partners that actually...
Because at the end of the day, it's their medical decision. I think it's also medical. As much as I don't support that, I sympathize with them, because after what I've been through in my life and seeing what other trans people have been through harassment and the rejection, you know, you may be in love with someone. Like, for example, I may meet someone that I absolutely, totally love. Like, every time I go on a date, I haven't been on a date since 2017. Or had sex since 2017, because I have severe anxiety meeting new people. And when I meet a man for the first time and he doesn't know that I'm trans, it's so crippling, the pain and worry of them not knowing how they're going to treat you if they find out that you're trans. And you like the person so much. So some of these girls they've taken it too far, and then it ends up in marriages. Yeah. And they have decided not to say anything because, number one, they feel comfortable with their husband. Their husband feel comfortable with them, so there's no need talking about it. There's no need hanging around trans people. They just do their own thing and live their life quietly.
Their husbands will just carry on believing that they have fertility issues. That's why they can't... Wow. Exactly. So, but the doctors would know, though, wouldn't they?
Doctors would know, but...
But they wouldn't disclose.
Your doctor confidentiality. Yeah. Your doctor don't disclose things. Mm. I have some friends whom their husbands know, but the husband says to them, they were out, and the husband tell them to come back in stealth so that the society around them don't know.
Yeah.
Their family, his family and information don't know. Like for me, when I meet my future husband, that is if I will ever get married, I don't think that will happen. But if I ever meet a guy that I want to marry in the future, I don't expect him to go and tell his family about me, because it's my life history. It's not his. I've met men whom I've dated who always go like, oh, I want to come out to my family and tell them I'm dating a trans man. I was like, excuse me, it has nothing to do what you and I do in bed and who am I, who I am, and my life history. It has nothing to do with your family members. Why do you have to out them? If they see me doing media breasting and they go like, oh, is she trans? You say, yeah, she is.
Yeah,
because I'm a cis woman. I am like any other cis woman, and I want you to treat me like any other cis woman. That is what trans people really want. Don't treat me any different like you treat another woman just because you're dating me. Don't treat me like a fetish. Don't think that, oh, it's so specialist that you need to come out with it. No, it's not your place. It's my story to tell, not yours.
Another question someone wanted to ask was, would you like to have kids?
Yeah, that was going to be my question. Oh, that was the last question I was going to ask.
My motherly clock had been ticking since 2009, I've always wanted to be a mom. So desperately, I tried. Mm-hmm. In fact, 6 years ago, I started the process here during the adoption.
Mm-hmm.
But because I live in a one-bedroom flat, they refused to give me a baby because they say I need a two-bedroom for them mm-hmm. to give me a baby. So I tried again when I'm now a godmom. And lately, I've been spending time with my godson. And I was looking at him and I'm like, oh, I want one as well. So my mom started the process for me in Nigeria, actually. But in the UK at the moment, they passed a law where we're not allowed to bring kids from Nigeria. They just passed that law earlier this year. So Nigeria, Cambodia, and some few other countries, about six countries on the list, because Nigerians bring these kids from Niger and then bring these kids to come and be their slaves to take care of their biological kids. So they are the health, childcare.
Yeah.
Childcare. So they bring the child, they are, these kids are the childcare, they adopt them from Nigeria as childcare for their biological children, which is not very nice. And they treat them really badly, finding body parts in the Thames, blaming them for witchcraft, you know, all this village stuff that they do. They bring it, import it to the UK here. So they've really messed up that situation. I want to be a mom. I wanted to do surrogacy as well. In fact, I was doing the research, but because of that, the process and how difficult it will be to bring a child over, I've decided to just can it for now. Now, I'm getting old and I feel like if I don't have a baby in the next few years, I'm not doing it anymore because it's not worth it.
Okay.
Miss Tara, let me just add a bit. There's an edge case with what you've just talked about. If you make an application to the Secretary of State and state your case, they can grant you I wouldn't say give
there
up.
There is an exception. My mom wanted to go ahead because something happened in Kaduna where they closed down an orphanage in Kaduna and they were looking for parents to come and adopt the kids. And I was thinking about doing that. But unfortunately, when they passed this law and the whole process, I just thought about the stress it would be because if I see the baby, I'm certainly going to fall in love with the child and I'm just going to be a complete emotional mess if they won't let me bring the child over. Because my mom was like, I can keep the child and take care of the child. The child will just be in your name, birth certificate and everything. I was like, no. Because I know my mom, I want to bond with the child and bring up the child as my own, not my mom doing it. So that's the reason why I'm just waiting. We'll see if the law changes. And if it doesn't change, I might take steps. But still, I've been warned in the UK here to even bring a child over, you still have to meet the adoption process here. It's not that straightforward anymore.
Yeah, it's complicated. You have to
be approved before you bring the child over. So the best route, in my opinion now, is through surrogacy. Because in surrogacy, that one, I created the child, so they have no choice but to let me bring the child.
How about fostering? Have you considered that?
I thought about fostering, but you still the same thing. You need extra space. If you don't have extra bedrooms, they won't let you.
You do.
The law is very stringent.
Another question I want to ask. So, like someone like Caitlyn Jenner, for example, she's how old she is before she...
She's 65, I think. 66.
Yeah, I mean, when she decided to go for her journey... What did she do any good for the trans community?
She doesn't represent us. We don't like her, and I won't hold back. I will say it. We don't like her. She represents the elite, the 1%, because she's such a rich woman, and she thinks that everybody, and she spoils the image for trans people. Because if you remember very well, like I was saying before, we lived very quietly. Before you still seeing all this attack in the press and media, it was through Caitlyn that this whole thing started. When she came out, we thought she was going to be good for us. Mm. But she keep on putting her foot in it with the saying the wrong things and being so against sex work, number one. And number two, she's also very much traditional and very right wing. You know, she's a Trump supporter. Mm. And she's very exclusive in the sense that she excludes certain trans women from womanhood. She's one of those people who her lived experience, she only became trans like 3 years ago. So she's like 3 years old being trans. Some of us have been trans for like a very long time.
I know. And isn't she giving the opposition an ammunition to attack? Yeah.
Yes,
she is, isn't she? Yeah.
She gives, because they use her as an example now. When transphobic people go, I'm not transphobic, but I like Caitlyn Jenner because Caitlyn Jenner conforms and holds my views. So it all boils down to politics as well, because this issue about being trans and us being ourselves to be our true selves has been politicized. And it's so sad to see what is going on. And they use her being a politician, because she's kind of a semi-politician. She's been trying to get into power, but they keep not electing her. And we're all celebrating. Good. Elected. So the problem is that if she doesn't know the subject, keep quiet. We have one in the UK here as well called India Willoughby as well. They always put their foot in it. I'm saying you just became who you are, your true self, right? You've lived as a white man all your life, and then all of a sudden you become a woman who done whatever you just, you know, you are who you are, but I'm sorry, you don't have the lived experience of most trans people.
Did she have the operation and all of those?
Yeah, I think she did. Yeah,
she did.
She did it like a year after. Oh, she went ahead and did everything because that is privilege. Many Black trans women don't have that kind of money.
They don't.
Yeah, most Black trans women don't even have the money to take time off work. They have to stand on the streets to survive.
Yeah.
So, but she lives in the comfort of her home. It was so easy for her to do. And then she sits down there and uses it to attack other trans people. And that is the reason why we don't like her.
Okay.
She's not nice to our community.
My final question before I close. So, I mean, the stories you can read on the internet where people who have gone through this whole process are then later regretting and say they want to revert back. They've had everything changed and done, but now they say no, they want to revert back, they wish they hadn't done it. How, I know you kind of mentioned it during the premiere last week.
Yeah.
What would you say to people who think that people are saying they made a mistake?
Yeah, I think Kiam made that statement last time when you guys were having that conversation as well.
Yeah, I was going to ask about it also.
Yes, because you watched in Al Jazeera. I think it was in RT, Russia Today. Okay, that says it all. It was Russia Today that carried that story originally. Maybe you watched it on a different channel, but it was Russia Today that published it originally. And I can assure you, Russia Today is anti-trans and anti-LGBT. So sometimes when you're consuming news stories or anything that has to do with trans person, look at the reporter that wrote the story or did the research, and also look at the platform that you're watching it on. For example, Breitbart, all this right-wing media organization, and all those people like Ben Shapiro and the rest, when they are talking about LGBT people and you consume their information, you need to step back as a Black person, step back, because the way they're attacking trans people right now, they will come for you later on because you're Black. These people are all racist motherfuckers who don't like Black people, and they will attack trans people. They pile us on together with Black people. And this is why it makes me so sad when Black people do not support trans people, but trans people will support Black people. That is the funny part of it all. When there is a protest or anything about Black Lives Matter, we are always in the forefront, but our Black community do not support us. Anyway, that's a different subject. All right. So now for the transition, so-called the transitioners, in my opinion, they were in trans in the first place. It's not my fault or other trans people's fault that you took that step to go and start taking such drastic step to take hormones and prescribe hormones to yourself and claiming that, the doctors forced you into it. No one forced you to do it. You willingly put yourself in there. You should have done your research very well. You're not trans in the first place. It means you're not trans. So therefore, don't sit down there and claim that, I used to be a trans person. If you're a trans person, it's impossible for you to detransition. Yes, there are some people who say, you know what? I took that step and I don't like it. And this is who I am. But it doesn't mean that I'm going to be attacking trans people. You won't see them in a show like that. Because I've met a few people who said to me that, I started the process, but I decided to step back because of the amount of hate I got. And also my family rejected me. I didn't feel comfortable. So I had to go back to being what I was assigned at birth because I feel more comfortable with that. That's fine. But in a situation where you go with somebody higher, that person, one man that calls himself somebody higher, they always put him in that story. He's always, if you watch that documentary, he's also there as well. They always use people like this because they feel that these people tells the story and make their case for them that there are trans people who would change their mind. How about the 100, what about the 99.999.999% of trans people who do not detransition? So if I should use that word, how about the trans people who have lived their life, all their life as trans, and never even thought about changing back or revert back to the gender that they were assigned at birth? How about that? The people who they amplify and the people's stories that you hear on a loudspeaker are very few minority of people. And it's the same people that they always use, that higher person and a few pocket of people. It's not a lot. They don't have a community anywhere. It's just a few number of people. That documentary only had, how many people did I interview when you watched it? There you go. And it's, there's a high, something, the oldest person on there, the oldest man on there, they've always been rehashing his story over and over. They've been doing it over and over again. This is because the right-wing media, who hate Black people, by the way, mm-hmm. often use this few pocket of people to discredit trans people and to say that, oh, their identity is not valid because they'll revert back. One day they'll wake up one morning and decide that this is who they are. Okay, if a trans person said they don't want to be trans or they are not trans, then don't be trans. You are trans if you are trans. If you are trans, if you've done... You've taken the process and you're living yourself as a, living your life as a trans. But when you say, oh, I'm not trans, then you're not trans. Why do you have to go and say that, oh, I used to be trans, but I'm no more trans? It doesn't make any sense, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And we all have been saying it collectively, that these people are just used as a political pundits to make us look like we are not true. There are so many trans people that you people don't know. Mm-hmm. Like I was saying to Adi earlier, there are so many trans people on walks of street that you could see in your work who don't stand out. They don't look trans. As people always say, oh, don't look trans. There are a lot of trans men. You see trans men, the voice, so their voices are so well changed. You see them with beard and everything. You see them walking that you will never believe that they're trans. And they are on there walking in the street and being with you. You could even be friends with one and don't even know.
Mm.
And if that is not an issue, why do we make it an issue? When somebody comes out to you and tell you their life history, it's like someone with mental health comes to you and tell you, oh, I have these mental health issues, or I have these health issues. And then you start using it to judge them and looking down on them. It's like a woman who has maybe, it's like someone who have HIV, for example. I always say that I would date someone with HIV. Because of my life history, I have that understanding of biology to understand that if I date a HIV person or even marry a HIV man, doesn't mean I'm going to catch the disease. But we as human beings always, we are preconditioned to go like, oh, yeah. I don't want to come near you. Oh my God, stay away from me. Don't use the same cup or spoon as me because I'm going to catch it. That is because we've been preconditioned to think that way.
Mm.
So being trans is medical, like any other. And when you find out about someone's medical life history, you should be the reason why you can't be friends with them.
Yeah.
Yes, they may not be your type that you want to have sex with. You may not be their type. It doesn't mean that they are bad people. They're still human beings like you. It doesn't mean, oh, because they are gay, don't come near me. Why would you want to go? Oh, hello, do you think the gay man wants to sleep with you too or what? If you don't have, if you're not gay and you don't have an issue with a gay man, why are you so worried in attacking them and harassing them and pulling them down and preaching against them constantly in the church if you're not inherently gay yourself? Because they say the people who suppress it are the ones who attack it. And the people who attack trans women are the ones who find trans women attractive. So I'm like, why do you attack people if you don't find it attractive? Just tell them to stay away. You don't find it attractive. And if you find out and you say, oh, I'm not interested, just quietly and politely remove yourself from the situation. You don't need to, hang out with the person and have sex with the person. You can just leave and go like, no, I'm not interested because you're just not my type.
Okay, so I want to round up, but I just feel this is a pressing question that our audience would want an answer to. And if you could just answer us in 30 seconds. Now, I think Ade also shared this notion, and a lot of people are saying when they meet a woman, and if the woman is trans, she should tell them immediately. Do you agree with that? And if you don't, why?
I don't agree with it because you don't ask any cis. If you're having that rules, then you should have it for cisgender women as well. Because they're saying that all cis women that you meet on the street should show their ID card and show their medical life history with you. It's like you said, oh, when you're walking down the street and you find someone attractive, oh, hello, I find you attractive, how are you? Okay, please tell me, are you a man or a woman? Because that's the question they're going to ask. They're not going to ask, are you trans? Mm. They're not going to ask that. They're going to ask, are you a man or a woman? I'm like, hello, look at me. Do I look like a man to you? Oh, no, you don't look like a man. You look like a beautiful woman. So why are you asking me a stupid question? That's a stupid question.
So at what point in that relationship, though, do you think the woman, the trans woman, would have to tell that person that, listen, this is it? Or
when the man makes you comfortable, for example, in my story is, so it's relative for everyone, right? Everybody is different, okay? So for me, how I deal with it is different from other people. In my case, when I'm on the dating website, plenty of fish. And when I'm chatting with men, it's not on my profile, but I wrote it on there. If you are homophobic, transphobic, if you are racist, if you are misogynistic, if you are just all around nasty right-wing motherfuckers, don't send the messages. I wrote it in my profile, I listed it on there. And guess what? People always pick on the trans part because that's what makes them go like, oh, what makes it? So yeah, are you saying to me that, oh, if I don't like transgender women, I can't date you. If you go into my profile, I have 300 messages waiting for me to respond to. So I get a lot of messages despite the way I've written my profile. So to keep it very short, I keep mine very simple. When I start chatting with the man, I will tell if they are transphobic or not. As soon as I start liking the man, because usually I don't respond unless I find the man attractive. And I go like, so what do you think about what I wrote in my profile based on the list I gave below? And then they will start saying, oh, gay, I have gay friends, or I have a brother who is gay. I don't really care about it. Trans people, I've never really met anyone before, but I don't mind, I would date a trans person. Then that is my key to actually go out on a date with the man. I won't tell him on the phone or because I want him to meet me as a person first. Yeah. Because if I tell him on the digital platform, he could just jump into conclusion, which I have done in the past, and they all block me. And in many ways, I actually like it because I don't want to be with a man who does not see me as a woman. I don't want to be with a man who just want to use me as a sexual fetish. Because majority of men, when I tell them that I'm a trans woman, in the beginning, they tell you, oh, you're so beautiful. I want to take you out on a date. Well, I want to spoil you. I want to do this for you. I want to do that for you. And then when they find out that I'm trans, oh, okay, you know what? Maybe the best thing is, let me just come to your house. Do you live alone? And I'm like, why are you asking me why I live alone? Oh, yeah, I'm sure I can come to your house instead of going out. I'm like, no, I'm sorry. I don't bring men home until I get to know them very well first. So I'm sorry, you're not coming to my house. Oh, come on, babes, you're so sexy. But I say, no, I'm sorry, I'm not meeting. Because number one, as hoochie, fantastic as I look, I don't want a man to treat me as a sex object or as a sex doll, as Adi suggested earlier.
Yeah.
I don't want to be used as a tissue paper when you finish wanking with me and then just dump me in the bin and move on to the next woman. Because most cisgender men who find trans women attractive, that is what they do. They use us to stagnate until they meet the right cisgender woman and then move on to the right cisgender woman. I don't want to be used. So for that reason, I put my foot down and make it very clear right from the beginning. I find out who they are first and what their views are first. Then I will know if I want to open up to the man.
Miss Sarah, sorry for interjecting. I just want to put a bit of twist in what Celia asks.
Okay.
I understand the dating apps where you can ask questions and get to know them better. But let's say you went clubbing. I don't know if you club, but let's say you went clubbing and this guy comes up to you and you guys meet and yeah, he likes you, you like him and you guys start talking. At what point, before it gets sexual,
I had a boyfriend who didn't know. I had a boyfriend who didn't know. And it didn't end well. After that experience, he's an Eastern European guy. And we met online and I told him his English wasn't very good. And I told him I'm a transgender woman. I told him that. And he didn't know the word transgender. He just thought it was just gender something. He said he felt it was gender something. So we did it for like a month. Things were going so well. We were planning on moving together. Everything was so good. Telling me how much he loves me and all of that. And we've already had sex, we've done things together already. And then he found out that I was trans and he just freaked out. He just went gray. And how did he find out? Through Nigerian bloggers writing things about me. He went into Google and searched my name and found out that I was trans. And he started freaking out. Then he came on camera and then we used to use Skype and it was like, oh, please tell me, is this true? Are you transsexual? And I said, yes, I'm transsexual. But I told you that I was transgender. He said he didn't know that. He thought I was saying that I was gender something. He just thought I was like maybe open to gender. That he didn't understand the word. That he didn't
know you were funny.
So I was like, oh, if that's the case, then that's it. Let's end it here. But I'm sorry. I will never be with a man who didn't know. And I'm very open with it. And I always tell men. And he got really upset. He started crying. This big guy, muscular guy that I've never seen, really upset before. He felt really uncomfortable. He said, oh yeah, but I enjoy the sex and you're like any other woman. I said, so what is the problem then? But so far I can see that you're very distressed and you seem very upset. I don't want to see you anymore. Then he started crying and begging me that he wants to see me and all of that. When we met, we tried to make it work in the next 3 weeks. It just didn't work because just like Ade, he was seeing me as a man. He just couldn't get it out of his head. Before that, everything was perfect. We were about to move in together. And then when he found out that I was trans, his behavior completely changed. He was very much distant, even when we tried to have, he would still cuddle me. And every time he cuddles me and we kiss, he had massive boner, massive erection. But once we start wanting to have sex and he inserts his penis inside my vagina, he goes flaccid. And I'm like, that is the worst insult you could give to a woman. And especially to a woman who has such a history of self-loathing and hating themselves. And then you've gone through all of this and then a man still looks at you like you're not a woman. You feel really rejected. So to just cut the story short, it didn't work out. It ended really badly and I kicked him out of my house and all of that. And, but he still wanted to keep him disturbing me. He wanted to see me. And I was like, no, for my own sanity and for my own mental health, you stay in your lane and I'll stay in mine. So the relationship didn't work out. So for me, it's very difficult, even when I'm out, because when I go out, it's even worse because I look, I have big hips, I have big ass, like what most black men likes. So I get
exactly
a lot of black men who find me attractive and it's always very difficult. For that reason, I always tell them, me no speak English, English no.
English.
Right. No, give me a number. Nah, English, nah. Just keep on walking.
Right.
I say, husband, husband. Because most times when I'm going, I wear an engagement ring in my ring finger just to distract men from disturbing me. Because of, hello, miss, hello, miss, excuse me, miss, excuse me, miss. They will keep disturbing me. And I keep telling them, no, because I know how it will end. A few times I've given my number out to men. And the one, I gave him my number around my area. He has this beautiful dog. We just got chatting. And that day I wasn't even glamorous. I was just looking normal. Like, because the times I'm not glamorous is the time that I get a lot of men after me.
Mm-hmm.
This guy, tall white guy, was good looking guy with his beautiful dog. And we're just going on about how he likes, just telling me how beautiful I am. I said, really? Are you serious? Are you blind?
Is it not? Yeah, got no makeup. Yeah.
I have no makeup on. I'm not dressed up. What the hell is he going on about? So he asked my WhatsApp number and I gave it to him. Then he went into my WhatsApp, because I have I don't use WhatsApp that much, but I have a WhatsApp that I give to men when I meet them for the first time, before I'll give them my main number. So I just gave him that. And we were having conversation and things were going well. He asked me for pictures. I think I did send him one picture. Then he now Googled my image on WhatsApp and then found out that I was a trans woman. And he became very rude, just sent me a message. So please tell me right now, I need to know. Because when we met, he kept telling me, please kiss me. So I said, no, I'm not kissing you. Because one thing I don't do is I don't get intimate with men unless they know that I'm a trans woman. I don't feel, I feel like I'm doing them justice as much as I don't owe them anything. I could just quietly have sex with them and move on. But for me, for my own sanity, I want to be with a man who knows my life history and feels comfortable with it. If you don't feel comfortable with it, then you don't deserve me. Just keep it moving. My confidence is that much of a titanium and that's solid. I don't feel that I need to be with men who don't fancy, who don't particularly respect who I am. I'd rather be with men who would actually respect me. And I have lots of them. I just, by decision, just want to be on my own. So anyway, so I just told him, I don't want to kiss you. And he kept saying, oh, please kiss me. I said, okay, I will kiss you on the cheek. And that's it. And that's what I did. So he was asking me all these questions like, oh, so tell me right now, you're transgender. Tell me. I was like, what do you mean? And I was laughing. I was like, haha, why are you asking me this kind of question? I was like, oh, just tell me right now. And I said, what is wrong with being trans? And then he blocked me. And since then, I see him around my area once in a while. He will see me, we see each other and pretend like we don't know each other. And in my head, I'm like, this is why I don't date around my area. And I don't date, I don't talk to people around my area. Since then, whenever a man says hello, I'm like, no, English, no. I keep on moving, just for my own safety. I get it, but I avoid it as much as I can. Unless they know I'm trans, I'm not going there.
Thank you so much, Mr. Hara, for coming on and sharing and answering all these questions from all these men. And I hope, I mean, what we thrive to do on Trash It is always to educate people. And I hope with this, we've been able to do that. And I hope that people haven't just watched this and, you know, feel, no, I'm not going to listen to what they've said and I'm going to continue with what I feel. I hope they would be open-minded and be able to treat people with respect, whether they're different from you for their sexuality or for whatever reason, or for their gender, whatever reason, I hope we'll be able to treat everyone with respect. I think that's the most basic thing that we can do for each other, for one another. And I hope, you know, as the world develops, people will become more open-minded and become more accepting. And unfortunately, I can see where culture and tradition has just, our brains are set already and it's hard for it to change, i.e. what Ade was saying and that guy you were going out with. And not just African tradition as well. Other European countries and Asia countries, they have the same mindset. But we're going to close now. I think we've been here for almost 2 hours, if not more.
Yeah.
We're going to close now. Thank you so much, guys, for watching this. And we will have Miss Sahara back on the show. I'm sure a lot of people will have more questions. And again, Miss Sahara, we'll invite you back. And there are other things that we want to talk about with you as well. So we'll definitely invite you back. Thank you so much, guys, for watching. We'll see you same time next week, every Saturday morning at 9:30 a.m. UK time. Thank you for joining us. See you later. Bye.
Bye. Bye.